Hi, everybody. This is Richard Sachs, your host on Lost Arts Radio. We're broadcasting worldwide on this show for Sunday, March 5th already. And we've got a really unusual, fun show for you tonight. And I think you'll enjoy it, but I have to kind of introduce it because it's a new topic that really wasn't even strongly on my radar until this week. And the reason it came up this week for me was I had some listener interaction, which I always do through email. You can always reach me at richard@lostartsradio.com. And I invite people to make suggestions for topics for shows and, you know, any comments or anything you want to share. And I've so far been able to read all of them and respond as fast as I can. So it came up this week that one of the listeners said, he recommended a subject that was really, you know, not one that I am usually focused on. And I thought, well, this is an illustration of the necessity for somebody who claims to be teaching anything to actually do what they're suggesting to people to do and not to, you know, just be doing everything in theory and not really following through. So one of the things that you've noticed that I recommend to people all the time is be open to new ideas, and that real science is not repeating acceptable information so that you sound like everybody else, but actual real science is complete skepticism and complete open-mindedness to everything at the same time. And if you're lacking in either one of those, you're not, your vision's not going to be open and clear. And so it was brought up to me, you know, what would be, if you look at the realm of conspiracy theories, and most of the stuff we talk about could easily be put in that category by people who don't know any better, you know, about all the health stuff that we talk about constantly. So what's even more unbelievable conspiracy theories, you know, you could think that, well, among all the other complaints about Donald Trump, that he's actually a Venusian agent or a Jupiterian agent or something like that, or a lot of different things like that. But there aren't that many people who actually believe that. But this listener brought up the fact that there are people who believe, not still believe, but recently believe, because of things that they've investigated, that the globe theory of the Earth being round is actually not accurate. And most people who, you know, would hear that for the first time would just think this is the most ridiculous thing they ever heard. And even the people that believe it mostly thought that at one time themselves. So they said, why don't you interview somebody who believes the world is flat? And I thought, my first reaction was, you know, it's not exactly what I had on the schedule. But then I had to realize that, look, you're inviting people to make suggestions and you're recommending that they're open-minded. And how can you do that? And if you're not going to be an example of that, the best you can. So I thought, all right. And I started looking at videos posted, which you can see easily on YouTube for free, of flat earth people giving various talks. And the ones that I found mostly, you know, didn't really appeal to me and had kind of other negative aspects to their attitude, in my opinion. And then I came across a guy named Mark Sargent, who had written a playlist series that I thought was actually really good, and it was called Flat Earth Clues. And I thought maybe he'd be willing to come on the air and have a discussion, as much, you know, for anything it would be to see, are we really scientific or open in our exploration and willing to just look at anything? We don't have to be threatened by it, because whatever is true is going to stay true. It doesn't need you to believe in it. So we're safe to just, you know, in a relaxed manner, look at everything. And I got a hold of Mark, and he was very kind in his busy schedule to be willing to come on right away tonight. So this is our show with Mark. It's completely unscripted, unplanned, except for I want him to talk about what's in the Clues series. And other than that, we can go anywhere. And sorry for the long lead-in, Mark, but I'm just really grateful that you quickly gave us some time. So thanks for being here.
Oh, no worries. And thank you for having me, Richard. And as far as intros go, I've had longer, believe it or not.
Okay. All right. Good. So anyway, I know you had told me in the brief few minutes of discussion about your background, which we can elaborate on, that you had been doing something with video games in a professional manner and then getting into teaching something about professional proprietary software, and maybe you could explain what that is and how that led up to your investigating this extremely unusual, outlandish in most people's opinion, conspiracy theory.
What ridiculous, when, stupid, insane.
Why you would even look at it, and what happened?
Yeah, the and the chain of events that led me to it, if I had to go back in time and try to change anything, I don't think I could, because everything leads me to this point, which is so odd. But I started my career, I'm one of the few people that actually played video games professionally for a living. You know, I think Gary Larson from the Far Side cartoons joked about that.
Who's going to pay you to sit around and play video games?
Well, it wasn't like I was sitting with a Super Nintendo or anything doing that sort of stuff. It was all PC and Macintosh based. But what happened was I won a computer pinball tournament back in the 90s, and it was a world tournament, and I got to test some of the company's new games as part of the prize. Not much of a prize, in my opinion. And I wrote a scathing review. I hated it. I hated their new game.
All right.
And what happened was the developer who was out of Japan, he was in the States at E3, at the E3 conference, and he thought, you know what? This guy is actually dead on. Why don't you hire him? So he made the recommendation, and then I interviewed. I flew out to Boulder, Colorado, and this was back in the glory days of video games. This is in the mid-90s, and it was a great time, if anyone remembers those days. Yeah. And then the company eventually folded. It was a small house, and honestly, if you weren't working out of California, your video game company wasn't going to really expand much. And I liked Colorado. It was kind of fun. I grew up in Seattle, Washington, just actually north of there, a place called Whidbey, Whidbey.
Yeah, and beautiful. I've been there.
Yeah, it's a beautiful place. Great place to raise kids. I was very naive. I grew up not believing in any conspiracies at all. I didn't think people even lied until I got off the island and went to college.
Yeah, that island is there's a lot of rain there. It's covered with beautiful trees and forests all over the place.
Oh, yeah. The colors of the Northwest are blue and green, and that's true. So after this company, and it was the company's name was Starplay, after they folded in the late 90s, Boulder was still a great place for software startups. So I went down the street and started working for a time and attendance company called Unitime. And that's not a time travel company, but it is short for Universal Time.
What does time and attendance mean?
What?
What does time and attendance mean?
Oh, time and attendance. That is time clock software. We would go out, you would own a factory, let's say, a blue-collar factory with hundreds of workers. Yeah. We would come out and replace all your manual time clocks with Ethernet time clocks. And hook it up to your PC, so when people punched in, it would go straight to your PC, and then you can manage all the time cards from your desk.
So that was really a cutting-edge development at that time.
Oh yeah, it was pretty cool. It was difficult software to build, because the rules when it came to time and attendance really varied, not just from state to state, but from county to county. So it was really buggy, and I had to come up with a lot of workarounds, and I really cut my teeth on problem solving through that company. And I did that for, well, all said and told, I was in Boulder for 20 years. And that's really how I got into, that's how I got good at problem solving. Did a lot of phone work, a lot of on-site installations, and I was very good at workarounds, trying clever ways of solving problems. Not necessarily textbook ways of solving problems, but clever ways. During that whole time, I never got married, never had kids. So I got into the whole conspiracy world, and that's how the path sort of led me to this. I'd gone through just about every conspiracy you could think of. I was in Boulder when the whole 9/11 thing happened, and looked at just about every conspiracy conceivable, and discounted some, didn't discount others. And then I looked at this thing. And
How did you even think to look at it, and who brought it up?
Just sheer boredom. It was recommended. In fact, it wasn't even recommended to me. It was just, I saw it in a random list of conspiracies in YouTube, and there weren't a lot of people doing it back in the last part of 2014, or the summer of 2014 when I looked at it. And there was a guy in Germany that kind of hinted. He said, you know what, the flights in the Southern Hemisphere don't make any sense. unless the world isn't a globe. And I go, oh, okay, that's interesting. And then I saw a video, a really sobering video with no graphics or anything, by an artist in Canada from Montreal, who said that he worked for NASA, and some NASA guy at some high level thing said that the GPS doesn't work out in Antarctica because it's flat, and he didn't get it for years and years. And so I said, okay, this is a good story. And then I started, and which I'll pose the question to your listeners right now. I'm trying to come up with different intros for this, because a lot of people are listening to this going, he cannot actually be saying what I think he's saying.
Right. So right.
My
it's
intro
the last time
to,
we'll ever listen to Richard or Lost Arts or anything like that. But that's fine.
Yeah. So my intro is this. How do you know, and I'm not asking you guys right now, how do you know you're on a globe right now? You know, because and if I ask 100 people that, eventually the consensus is going to be, well, because we saw the picture, because NASA told us, because we've seen the live streams and the images. Yeah. I go, okay, that's good. But how did you know before NASA? Because it's not like we woke up one day in 1972 and said, oh, hey, by the way, the Earth's actually a sphere. And we say in our community, we're trying to say sphere or globe or ball, because round, you know, a dinner plate is round. But
yeah, three-dimensional.
Yeah, three-dimensional
sphere.
A
lot of people would also answer you that the astronomers figured it out.
Right. Before NASA, they're going to say, well, the astronomers told us, and science told us. I go, okay, but how did they tell you, and how did you know? You got to remember that with just about everything else when it comes to physics, you know, fire burns, water is wet, you drop something, it falls to the floor, it's either pulled or pushed, it's called gravity. These are some things you could test right now. But when it comes to what the Earth looks like, this is something you're told. And you have to go on faith. It's not something that you or your neighbor or anybody's neighbor that you know has been up there and checked. Sooner or later, somebody's got to go up high enough to where the Earth starts curving below them. And then all of a sudden you say, oh, look at that. It actually is a ball.
Or if you traveled in one direction and got back to where you started, that would prove part of it, right?
Well, I can move my finger in a circle around a dinner plate. Doesn't mean the dinner plate's a ball.
Well,
just
I'm running my circle around
a dinner plate.
Keep turning left, though, if you go straight.
Well, that's just it. If we're talking about something as huge as the Earth, then a very, very gradual left turn or a very, very gradual right turn. It's easy. People make the mistakes that ships made for years and years and years was the reason why all our maps were completely distorted.
Okay.
Don't get me started on the Mercator map, which we still use in classrooms, that science will tell you right now is absolutely wrong. Everyone knows that at the very least the Gall-Peters map is more accurate, but they won't replace
them. Even if the globe theory is correct, then the Mercator map is wrong, right?
Yes. Oh, yeah, yeah. Even if the globe theory is correct, the Mercator map is wrong. But they won't replace it because it's a jar to the system. They like to keep the status quo. So my thought, the thing I postulated was, and what, at least part of my clues, was, all right, let's say science built this model, this globe model, and it's been sitting out there for 500 years, but they didn't have a way to prove it, not literally. And you say, no, we prove it with sticks and shadows and sun rays and all this other stuff and all these complex equations. I'm like, okay, that's fine. But you don't know until you get high enough to see it. You may be 99.999% sure, but until you see it, what do you really know? And the thing I postulated was, okay, if you did get high enough and you realized it wasn't a globe, would you inform the public? And then it turns into sort of like a science fiction movie, because you know full well the powers that be, they like to keep things running smoothly. And if there's any chance that the public reacts badly to this, they're going to hold on to it, not to mention the massive repercussions that would ripple through our civilization from academic to economic to religious. It would completely turn our way of thinking upside down. And if you think that I'm making sort of a reach here and a stretch, let me give you another example of what science can do. You've all seen the textbooks when they show the cross section of the Earth, right? You know, if you believe in mainstream science, it's 4,000 miles to the center of the Earth. And we all seen the cross section, which looks like a gobstopper candy cut in half, which you've got your red and your orange band and your yellow band and your white band going down to the center. That's supposedly 4,000 miles to the center. You're thinking,
the center's supposed to be liquid too, right?
Yeah, yeah, liquid and spinning molten nickel and iron.
Really hot liquid.
I don't know. But it doesn't really matter because I say, okay, well, what's the deepest probe ever drilled? Is it half that distance, 2,000 miles, 1,000 miles? No, 100? 10? The deepest hole ever drilled is only 8 miles. So how exactly do you know what is down underneath the earth? And if you go on Wiki right now, science will, they use flowery language, but science will say, no, we extrapolated. We expanded. We did all this. Well, basically, right. It's a guess.
And there's no ground penetrating radar to go 4,000 miles.
No, there isn't. And so so I also put out there, it's like, okay, why don't the textbooks, when you see a cross section of the earth, why isn't there just a big question mark on the inside of it? And on top of that, even if you could convince me that you have ground penetrating radar that can tell exactly what's 4,000 miles down, that's this world. How are you giving me cross sections of every other planet in our solar system going all the way out to Neptune and Uranus? How is that even happening? You want to say that what's underneath our feet right now? Fine, I may give you the benefit of the doubt in a best case scenario. But anything off of this place? No.
I didn't realize that the astronomers were saying here's a cross section of Jupiter and things like that. Is that what they're doing?
Oh yeah. Because, and I actually got into a debate with a science educator out of London. Oh God, was it last week? And I put it to him, and he was backpedaling really, really fast. I said, is there any time that you've seen where science will just leave the question open? Where science won't take the leap of faith? People say, oh, science doesn't take leaps of faith. That's for religion. I go, oh, no. Science takes leaps of faith all the time. But what they do is if they repeat it enough that and just put it in the textbooks, it just becomes fact through repetition, osmosis.
That's a really good point. I mean, there aren't books and maps full of question marks, and there should be.
No, because in, now science will put a, in the fine print, you will be able to find and say, oh, yeah, we don't really know. But the thing is, if you put the graphic out there and you don't put that disclaimer on every page where the graphic is, people just assume that you know what you're talking about.
That's where
this whole thing started. So when I was looking at this, back in 2014, before I made the clues, I said, okay, everyone in the Flat Earth community right now, they start out, in fact, the t-shirt could be, I became a Flat Earther because I tried to debunk Flat Earth. I tried to stomp this thing into the ground because I thought it was a stupid theory. Everybody does.
Okay.
It's a dumb, ridiculous theory. But what's interesting is that nobody knows why it's dumb.
What I've noticed, too, is that only the intellectually brave people that are emotionally grounded in themselves and not really fearful are willing to try to debunk or seriously question things that everybody says they know.
Yeah.
Because it's too emotionally threatening.
And that's a good point that you just said, that they know. The great George Orwell, the writer of the book 1984, he wrote an article, and you guys can look this up, in 1946 for the Tribune, where he was talking about the responsibility of science. And he's not a flat earther, keep in mind. But he said, it's interesting. You go to ask anybody on the street how they know that the world is a sphere or a globe. And their first response is almost always the same. It's like, well, duh, we know. It's a given. It's like algebra. We know it's a sphere.
Yeah.
And if you put it to them, you say, well, how do you know exactly? Then they start getting upset. And
it's like the FDA puts out lists of chemicals in your food that are generally recognized as safe, and they include all kinds of deadly poisons.
But it
doesn't matter because they're in the safe list.
Yeah. And don't think that science is infallible. And I will say his name for interviews, even though I don't like saying his name, Neil deGrasse Tyson, the world's most popular astrophysicist and TV personality. He's really fond of saying that science is right whether you believe in it or not. And I come back and say, look, science is, in my opinion, one of the most ruthless institutions that's out there. Science, we'll put aside just for the moment the military applications. That's when you ask a science to build you a weapon, that's what you're paying him to do.
But the guy that you just quoted was referring to real science, not what's practiced now.
Well, yeah, there you go.
He was right about that.
What?
It's science just that is... no one's doing it.
Yeah, there you go. But he, it just was something. Here's the thing. Science will protect its own. That's one of the big points I'm trying to drive here, and that is science is no different than any corporation, any political institution. They will protect their own. You can't ask science to be to shoot themselves in the foot if they find something that goes against science. It's the Raiders of the Lost Ark scenario, which is, we all remember the movie from the early 80s where it's that magical artifact, the Ark of the Covenant, which supposedly held the Ten Commandments. Right. Well, when they finally got it, when the Americans got it in the end, what did they do with it? They put it in a crate, they put it in a warehouse, they sealed it up, and nobody ever saw it again. And
yeah, that's the whole point, right?
Yeah, that's because it went against science. If it cannot be explained, science does not want it being out in the open. I'd like to call science magic without mystery, meaning it a couple hundred years ago, it's magic. But if you can repeat it and the average person can use it, then it becomes science. No different than trying to explain a microwave oven to somebody even 100 years ago.
Well, yeah, magic is just anything you don't understand, but which is actually happening.
There you go. There you go. So I ended up wrestling with this thing for the better part of 9 months. And finally, in the beginning of 2015, I decided, you know what? There's no way. I mean, I think I've got it. I consider myself a very good creative problem solver, given enough time.
Yeah.
So I decided to make a series of videos and put it out on the internet. And I had an old YouTube channel, but I didn't really use it. Not for posting things anyway. And I made a series of videos called The Flat Earth Clues, which put out to the internet, okay, I don't think it's a globe anymore. I cannot prove it's a globe. I definitely can't prove it on the ground. And if you don't trust NASA, which I don't, then you're really going to have a hard time with it. And I started making, I only did 11 or 10 to start, and then 11. I think it's up to 13 now, but it doesn't really matter. You get the bulk of it in the first 11.
Yeah.
And I put it out to the internet, and I thought for sure that somebody in the academic world or some sort of physicist or astronomer, somebody would have called me up or written me a letter and said, okay, here's why you're wrong. Here's the proof. There you go.
Yeah.
And instead of that,
I would think that, right.
Yeah, why not? It's the easiest thing to disprove in the world.
That's what I would do. If I knew the answer, I would send it to you by email the first day I saw it.
Sure. Sure, and I was waiting for that. I was waiting for people to quote. But the thing was, they kept quoting me things. In fact, I got an email today with the assumption that it was a globe in the first place. That you can't quote me globe math and think you're going to convince me. Because, like, look, you're assuming that it's a globe, no different than a geodetic surveyor that surveys based on his assumption that the Earth is a globe. When he's talking about such
a really great... You should give an example of that for people that aren't quite following what you're talking about.
Oh, you mean globe math?
Yeah, you're saying if you make a certain assumption, which is the rules of globe math, then you can't use that as the basis for a proof that the globe is the right model.
I'll do one better, because in the clues, we didn't even touch on this, and then people really latched onto it. And I was kind of regretting not doing a clue on it after the fact, which was globe math says that the curvature of the Earth is 8 inches roughly. I mean, it's a little higher once you get up in 1,000 miles, 2,000 miles, but it's 8 inches per mile squared, which means it's 8 inches times every mile times itself. So if it's 1 mile, there's 8 inches of curvature. If it's 2 miles, it's 2 times 2, which is 4 times 8 inches, which is 32. 3 is 72, and so on and so on.
In other words, the amount that it drops from level ahead of you,
yes,
it goes down with the distance away from where you're standing.
Yes.
And the amount that it drops vertically because of the curve is by that formula.
Yes, and that's mainstream science. You know, we didn't come up with this math. And what was interesting was, because people kept quoting that to us, and so we thought, okay, we should go out on a body of water, because it's the only thing you can actually say that science isn't going to come back and say that it's not level. I mean, like, for example, Kansas is a university did a study on this some years ago, is literally 99.99997% flat. It's as flat, it's flatter than a pancake. But the science will come back and say, well, no, that's just a flat, very flat piece of land on a ball. And it's like, really? An entire state? And not just Kansas. There's other places, you know, like that. It's like, all right, fine. So you go out to a body of water because we all know that sea level is level. You know, water is level. You pour it, it will always find its level. So you start looking at objects across bodies of water. And let's say, for example, you're looking across a body of water that's 50 miles, 60 miles.
Oh, no. Mark, I got to ask you and interject one important question there.
Sure.
That I think people might think of. If you're considering water to be flat.
Yes.
What happens when you have the issue of the fact that it moves with tides?
Oh, that won't affect it. It won't affect this calculation because regardless,
it still stays level.
It stays level. Even if the tides are in play, it'll stay level. Now, the only thing that's going to mess you up when you're looking across a body of water is wind, of course, atmospheric conditions. There's also a thing called atmospheric lensing where it will magnify things depending on how you're looking at it. Now, some people will say, you know, here's where what I'm getting at. So, like, if you look across a body of water, a calm body of water, you're looking at buildings or lighthouses or something, and and maybe it's 50 miles away. Well, that's several thousand feet of curvature between, you know, it's 50 times 50 times 8 inches divided by feet. That's several thousand feet of curvature. And yet we can still see those buildings. And, you know, we've seen this in not just still shots, but time-lapse video. The Chicago skyline's a perfect example, although there's plenty of others out there. Some Hawaiian islands at 80, 90 miles away. In fact, there doesn't seem to be a distance other than, you know, you get about 150 miles out, then you start having problems looking through anything because you got to remember our atmosphere is not... It can get pretty soupy. I mean, we're basically breathing. What we're breathing in isn't exactly. I mean, it's not. Well, one, it's only 20% oxygen. We're breathing in mostly nitrogen.
Yeah, exactly. And so if you're looking at something 50 miles away, because of the curvature of the Earth, how much lower than where you're standing is it supposed to be?
Oh, several thousand feet. You should not be able to see it at all, and yet we can see it. In fact, the challenge I've put out to science recently. Is find me an object at 100 miles or less that we can't see over a body of water. Find me something that we can't see. And they'll say, well, no, it's a mirage. And I'm going, well, even a superior mirage is inverted. So how are we seeing these things straight up through multiple weather conditions, through video? And what's really the reason why we can do this now where we couldn't even 10 years ago is the camera technology. Camera technology is you can get like the Coolpix 900 with 83 power zoom, and you can double that with one of their lenses. You can zoom in on things, for example, because people say, well, no, we see boats going over the horizon. Okay, fine. Watch a boat go over the horizon and you think it's gone. It's gone over the curve, right? Then break out a pair of binoculars. Can you see the boat? Well, no. Okay, break out a really high-powered digital camera. Well, there's the boat. And this thing's 20, 30 miles away. How can you see this boat? It's supposedly over the hill, over the curvature. But yet we can always see it.
And I also, when people are listening to you go through these points, I want to encourage listeners to say, let's debunk what Mark is saying. And you bring up the points that we said the scientist should have emailed to him right away.
Oh, yeah.
And say how what he's saying is incorrect or not logical.
Yeah, don't take my word for it, which was why I put at the end of every single video, like, do your own research. Ask your own questions.
It's what you did. Yeah.
I started out like everybody else. I thought that Flat Earth was the worst conspiracy of all time. And then as I dug into it more and more, it started turning into the P.T. Barnum saying. If you remember P.T. Barnum from Barnum and Bailey Circus, he was the other guy that says sucker is born every minute. But he also said something that was very interesting. He goes, you know, you can fool some of the people all of the time and all of the people some of the time. And, you know, the rest of it, you know, you can't fool all the time. But all the people, some of the time, I never could find a good example for that until I saw this. And then it hit me. It's like, holy smokes, you can fool everybody.
You can't analyze or debunk something if you're worried about what the implications of finding out that it's true might be.
Yeah, yeah. There's you have to be open-minded enough. In fact, there was one of the members of our community. He goes, you know, this is the ultimate open-minded test. Because, mm-hmm. and I said that in the very first clue, I literally know people who will cosplay and dress up like aliens and go to alien conventions. Mm-hmm. And yet I could go to this person, he's wearing a freaking alien costume, and I can say, flat earth. And he'd be like, get out of here, and just walk away.
Yeah, that's exactly. That's normal alien stuff. Right.
Because it's the only conspiracy you can't walk away from. You know, if you don't want to believe in 9/11 or Pearl Harbor or JFK or Sandy Hook or Boston, any of that stuff, mm-hmm. you don't want to believe in that, fine. You don't have to. There are secrets out there that can be buried in the desert forever. But when it comes to this, this is something that really hits home because you're walking on it. And up until now, you've only even heard of such a thing in science fiction movies, like Twilight Zone episodes. And I never ever thought, or movies recently, the one that always comes to mind, which because it's such a great example, is The Truman Show, which mm-hmm. is, because they asked him in a very small segment of the show, the TV producers asked him, it's like, hey, how does Truman not pick up on this? How is he not knowing that he's actually in a Hollywood soundstage? And the producer was very frank about it. He said, you know, we accept the world that is presented to us. And mm-hmm. when I watched, and you're thinking, well, you know, that's Hollywood. It's a big soundstage. It's not like, I'm going, no. It can be done very, very cheaply. As long as you're born into it, you will believe it. Which means, you know, look at the M. Night Shyamalan mm-hmm. movie, The Village, which was a mm-hmm. brilliant movie, even though it didn't do well in the reviews. But the concept was brilliant. And that was, if you take children and you take them and you build a city in the middle of nowhere, you can basically tell them anything. And they are going to believe it.
They believe that they were growing up in the early 1800s or something, right?
Yeah. They were growing up in the 1800s and they didn't even know if there was another city where, you know, they were the only city around. They lived basically in their own little world. And that was just done by raising kids in a remote piece of real estate out in the middle of nowhere where you made sure that the planes didn't fly over it.
And you made the culture such that nobody thought about long distance travel, right?
No. And since you didn't promote technology and advancement in technology, you could keep it that way more or less forever. Mm-hmm. And that's where this thing kind of was born, where it's like, okay, how do you know it's a globe? Do you know it's a globe because you saw it in your classroom when you were 6 years old and it just followed you until you graduated from high school? Is that why you know it's a globe? Or do you know it's a globe because you saw a picture that was taken in 1972? And it was literally, I'll throw another example out for you. Of course, we can't go back in time, and the Wayback Machine, the Internet archives don't go back that far. But when I was doing support for the time and attendance company, I mm-hmm. wanted to put iconic pictures of the globe. I thought it was, I loved the globe. I used to collect antique globes. And okay. I wanted to put iconic globe pictures on all the different computers, but I wanted one for each, you know, different one for each one. And I did these Boolean searches online, and the internet wasn't super like great like it is now, but it wasn't bad. This is back in 2000. Mm-hmm. And I typed in, you know, pictures of the Earth from space and every other combination I could think of. And I kept getting back exactly one image. It's not like when you go in now and you see all these different weird computer-generated images. There was literally only one picture that was released. It was the Apollo 17 picture, and everyone would recognize it, showing the bottom part of Africa and all of Antarctica. And I thought, my first impression was, it's like, NASA, you suck. Your internet presence is horrible. You can't tell me this is the only picture you guys ever released. But actually it was. Literally, it was the only picture NASA ever released of a full Earth in sunlight from 1972 until 2015. The middle summer of 2015, when all of a sudden our community started harping on this, saying, where are the other freaking pictures? And then mm-hmm. they started coming out, well, at least attempting to come out with more, but they were just butchered. So you're thinking, okay, what does that mean? Well, I'll go, okay, it's 43 years and one picture, all these space missions, all these satellites, the Hubble telescope, nobody released a picture, a second picture of the Earth.
Yeah, there should be really good ones because they've sent probes to other planets all over the place.
Oh, there should be pictures everywhere. I mean, there should be a 24/7 real-time channel called the Globe Channel or the Earth Channel that, that all it does is shows the Earth, you know, doing sunrise and sunset. It could be geostationary.
Right, and of course, if it shows, it would look like a two-dimensional circle, but if they could show it spinning...
Exactly.
Parts of it coming into view, that would end the discussion.
Yeah, and that's what really that here's the problem. When the people that are listening to this, when you go out, you're going to try to do what I did, and you're going to try to lean on the space program and say, "Well, there's obviously all this information that's out there, and it's got to be true." It's like, "Okay, find the pictures that aren't composites," and you won't find them because the second blue marble shot wasn't even released until 2015. I mean, and we know that.
And when you say they're composites, you mean there's little pieces of pictures put together,
or they're completely fabricated from square one. The guy that the very first iPhone background was, no big surprise there, a globe, and that was created by a guy at NASA named Scott Simmons, and he's been interviewed in audio. You can hear his radio interview where he says, "Oh yeah, it was totally Photoshopped," but he said it has to be because there was no image for him, no other images for him to get, and we tore that one apart because he got a little lazy and he was using the Photoshop cloning tool, especially in the Southern Hemisphere, and you could see cloud formations which are absolutely cloned. Where he just get, you know, guys, well, let's spruce it up a little bit here. If anyone's used Photoshop, you know what I'm talking about, where he's just replicating chunks of clouds, but you can pick up on these things because, it, you know, organic
so
is organic.
So in other words, he was admitting that there are no available pictures.
No, there were no available pictures. And so, okay, that's only one part of it. And again, once you start looking into the space program, you start learning about, it's not that, here was the problem we were running into. It's not what we found. It's what we didn't find, meaning that one of the first things we noticed was that there are no videos of any astronaut from any program, from Mercury and Gemini to Apollo to Soyuz, whatever, where the astronaut is outside of a spacecraft, and this could be on the moon, it could be up in orbit, it doesn't matter, where he does 180 degree or further pan with the camera, with the video running. It's never ever
happened. Holding the camera all the way to his right to all the way to his left.
Yeah, just turn around with the camera running. And it never, ever happened. You'd think
you're saying facing the Earth or facing in any direction?
Facing anywhere. It never happens. And I was going, and on the moon especially, you'd think, hey, let's take it doesn't take that long, hit the video camera and just spin around, whether it's a television camera or a video camera, you just turn around. And that was one of the first things that we noticed wasn't there. Statistically, very unlikely. There's no videos currently of the Earth rotating on its axis with the weather morphing. You can do.
Right.
You can get one.
That would be the end of this whole discussion, right?
Well, it would certainly help them. It would help their case. But even if they released it now, we'd cry out angry wife syndrome, which is the analogy I came up with. It's like, okay, husband comes home after 40 years of marriage, and his wife goes, "I'm leaving you." And he goes, "Why?" And, "Well, because you only brought me flowers once in 40 years. So what happens the very next day?" He brings her a thing of flowers. And she'd be like, "Look, you only brought them for me because I asked for them." So even if they released it now, it's not going to be the silver bullet because it's too late, because it's deliberate. For example, the Himawara satellite, which shows weather morphing but the Earth not rotating, that was released in the summer of 2015. The shot of the moon it was only 20 frames, even though it was supposedly covering like 5 hours, the moon transiting in front of the Earth, that was within 2 weeks of the Himawara satellite, also in the summer of 2015, after we asked for it. It's like,
well, yeah, but the question is whether it could be fake or not, right?
Oh, they're absolutely
however
fake.
Terrible they are for waiting 40 years, if it's real, it doesn't matter.
If it was real, if it was real, but it's not. We still, again, you will not find, you can get one or the other. You can see a globe with the weather morphing, but it's not spinning, or you can see a globe spinning, but the weather isn't morphing. You can't get both. And you think, what, you can't hook up a supercomputer and generate weather patterns? It's too complex for you. How are you not releasing this? I'll take a couple more. There is no footage of any device leaving the Earth's atmosphere, leaving the Earth's orbit, or coming back. Where the Earth all of a sudden, you see it start turning into a globe, from the pad, and then it becomes a globe, and then it starts fading off into the distance. Okay. Nor do you see, like, when they went to the moon, supposedly it wasn't just one mission, it was supposedly Apollo 8 through 17. There's no footage of the heading towards the moon, where the moon all of a sudden gets bigger and bigger and bigger. It's just these weird cut edit scenes. We don't even have footage of an astronaut in the freaking airlock, where his camera's on, and where he opens up the airlock and it follows him out. And cameras are dirt cheap nowadays. 4K cameras are everywhere, and it was just amazing the amount of stuff you don't see. And the ISS, for example, the International Space Station, it's celebrating its 20-year anniversary next year. There is no footage. One, there's no time-lapse footage of this thing even being built. So you'd think that they would, at least through CGI, would come up with some sort of time lapse of the great ISS being built, and there is none. And all the people that have visited supposedly the ISS, there's no footage of them. You'd think, especially with the Japanese, they're camera happy. Cameras on the side of the spacecraft going up and then docking and then going in. Nope, nothing. It's just not there. We've assumed it all. Everything we've assumed because of all the science fiction movies that have been made over the years. We assume they were always there, but it turns out instead of a warehouse full of wonderful evidence, it's just empty cardboard boxes. And it's so thin that the community, again, I would love to lean on NASA and the space program, but there's nothing there for me to lean on. In fact, there's so little there that we finally had to come back and say, space program is a piece of crap. Forget about the Apollo program, which has not aged well, by the way. I could go off on so many different rants. Which is why it was so surprising when SpaceX announced, 3 days ago, that they were going to actually take tourists on a slingshot around the moon next year. Can't wait to see how that.
Yeah, that's going to be really interesting to see what
can't be done. Cannot fake it. Logistically. They're saying that they're going to prove something. They're going to produce media that's never been produced ever.
When I was the year that Disneyland opened, I went there as like a 4-year-old or something, and I rode on a 3-stage rocket, and I could see everything through the windows. It was amazing.
By the way, that's also a great. You and I are kind of on the same page. Disneyland. You've been to Space Mountain?
I was there only in 1954, not after.
Oh, wow. All right. Okay. So Space Mountain, which is the indoor roller coaster, that is sort of like what we're talking about here. Because people are saying, what are you talking about? What is the flat Earth like? It's like the Truman Show. It's like a planetarium, a terrarium, a wildlife preserve, a sports stadium. Basically, if you could take the Truman Show and build it out thousands of miles wide and a few thousand miles high, that's all you need. Could you hide an entire civilization inside it? And yeah, you could. And then once you did, how many people would have to keep it a secret? Not that many. Not as many as you might think. And that's where, and I don't know, we can go over the clues a little bit in terms of broad strokes, but that's what I postulate. It's like, look, how would you, because I grew up and was trained as a problem solver. So the thing I put out there was, all right, let's say this is possible. Let's say this is, this is feasible. How would I hide the world? Let's say I discovered it, because, we didn't build it. It was built by, someone or some group a lot more advanced than us, obviously.
What do you mean, how would you hide the world? What does that
mean? Let's say you went out. Let's say this thing was as old, very, very old, and other civilizations have lived in it. But you wouldn't be able to even detect it until you had advanced enough technology, most notably the internal combustion engine. And that wasn't even invented until, 1900? So 1900 rolls around, then you can start creating aircraft, gasoline-powered aircraft, and then you could start looking for this thing. So it'd be, the thing I like to tell people is, like, look, let's say you were the king of France in 1600, and you had a map showing what the world really looked like. What good would it do? You've got wooden ships and horses. You're not going to be able to do anything. Even if you could get to Antarctica, which is an extremely unusual continent, you know, there's no animal life, no plant life. It's the sheer wall of ice that goes up 200 feet from the shoreline. Plus,
they do have penguins there, right?
The what? Well, at the beach, sure. At the beach, there's penguins, but that's about it. And inland, there's nothing. The place just screams, go away. So let's say you did know about this. You didn't, until you had internal combustion engines, you're not even going to come close to figuring out for sure where we are. And so that's when they took Admiral Byrd, the world's greatest modern explorer and the United States' youngest admiral of all time. They put him in a plane and basically had him flying around Antarctica from 1928 all the way up until 1956, looking for the edge, the boundaries. I don't like to say edge because people say, well, if it's an edge, you'll fall off. The boundaries of this world, the fence line, the gun line.
Well, now that's an assumption that's what he was looking for, right? Because
it is an assumption. But what happened after the last mission, it was everything pointed. Let's put it this way. Yes, the clues that I made connected dots. That's all that, you know, I like connecting dots and making leaps of faith if I can. But what happened after his last mission, which was in 1955, 1956, which was Operation Deep Freeze? Once he got done with that mission, the world changed. All the governments, the relevant powers of the world acted very, very strangely. And that led into my thing, because it was good timing, because I said, all right, how would I hide the world? Meaning, let's say I found the border of the world and I didn't want people to go there. What would I do to protect it? And the first thing I would do is, like, okay, I'd hide the upper edge and I'd hide the outer edge. It's easy enough to do. You just militarize space, and most people don't have, you know, we don't have Jetsons cars, so nobody's going up high enough because it's way higher than commercial traffic or even spy plane altitudes. So you militarize space, and NASA is a military organization. Don't think for a second that it isn't. It is DOD, founded on the still burning embers of the Nazi war machine. Wernher von Braun is the father of NASA, and he was one of Nazi Germany's most decorated scientists.
So NASA was started as one of the results of Operation Paperclip, is that right?
Yes. Well, yes. Yes. Well, yeah. The scientists they brought back, that NASA was more founded, though, because of the atomic weapons testing, otherwise known as Operation Fishbowl, which is an interesting name, where for whatever reason, after Admiral Byrd got back from Operation Deep Freeze, they started the Soviet Union and the United States started firing nuclear weapons up straight up for 4 years. That's all they did, was fire nuclear weapons, just fire, you know, big ones in the beginning, you know, megatons, back when megatons were very, very pricey.
Yeah, everybody assumes that testing was to make sure they could blow up the world.
Yeah,
right. And each other, but and everybody
from our standpoint, it was no. They were mapping out the sky. But first, it was like, okay, can we bust through this thing? You know, can we bust through the barrier that's above us, the dome? And after that, once they figured out they couldn't, they just started using kiloton weapons to just figure out, okay, what are the exact dimensions of this thing? What's the curvature of it? The arcs, anyway. And at the same time, what was interesting, here were the big ones. The big ones, changes that happened were in 1959, where in 1959, two very important things happened. One was the Van Allen radiation belts were announced by Van Allen, a NASA employee, go figure. And the Antarctic Treaty was signed. And the Antarctic Treaty, you cannot underestimate this thing. And please look it up if you get a chance. None of the stuff I'm telling you, by the way, is secret information. You can look it up and see the broad moves that were made yourself. The Antarctic Treaty was put in place in 1959, same year as the Van Allen radiation belts. Van Allen belts basically saying, don't go up there. There's something super, super deadly. And if any humans go past it, they're going to die.
And what altitude was that supposed to be at when it was in?
That Alan Reedy must totally start, I think, about 500 miles, okay, give or take, and this extend upwards of 60,000 miles deep, some to that effect. Okay. And but we'll get into that in a second. The second part was the Antarctic Treaty, which says, and I'm not exaggerating when I say this, that no corporation anywhere in the world can do anything in Antarctica ever. That's the short version of it. So if you all of a sudden, Richard, decide to create your own country and you become an economic power, you will have to sign this treaty. And the treaty says none of your corporations can go down to Antarctica ever. The treaties, it's the only treaty ever in the history of treaties that has gone this long without anybody even challenging it.
So there were like 150 countries that signed it or something like that?
Everybody signs it. If you trade in the world, you have to sign this country. And it's not even up for debate until the year 2041. And and you know full well, and here's where it gets weird. Richard Byrd, the world's greatest explorer, went on national television and said in 1954, and this is when I think they were almost ready to give up, and that's Murphy's Law for you. It's like, the world's not flat, apparently. Let's just carve Antarctica up and go after resources. He said, look, there's an entire mountain range made out of coal that can supply the entire world. There's oil, there's minerals, there's uranium. Let's just make money. In fact, he was worried that...
I saw the black and white video of that interview, yeah.
Yeah, it was a brilliant video. It was on a show called The Long Jeans Chronoscope back in 1954. It was kind of like a 60 minutes of their time. It was a watch company. That's why they called it the Long
Jeans Chronoscope. Yeah.
And yet no oil company. Here's what gets even weirder. Not only are no corporations allowed to go down there, no corporations are even allowed to talk about going down there, even suggesting it. I mean, if I'm the head of Exxon, I'm going to go to the New York Times and I'm going to run a full page ad every month saying how great it would be for Exxon to go to Antarctica. I'm going to grease the palms of every politician I can. I'm going to hire the best lobbyists and I'm going to go down there. And we all know this. I mean, look at the fracking in the United States. You can, if somebody wants to frack in your backyard, they can start pretty much next week. It's only a question of who they're going to get to. If they get to your neighbors, if they get to the local politicians, the only place they're not fracking right now are places where there's no resources to frack. So you're telling me these companies can't go to Antarctica, can't even talk about going to Antarctica? It completely goes against what we are as a civilization that runs on.
So what happens when you start asking official people why that's the case?
It never happens. Well, I can tell you what happens behind closed doors. That it's because I know what I would do. And that is, if a major oil company was even considering it, you monitor the email traffic and tap phones and whatever you need. And if anyone even starts thinking about going to that path, you go to the highest level of the exec of that company or the board, and you say it's a matter of national security. It's, you're not allowed to even talk about it. And if you even think about going against us, we will stop you with a federal injunction.
Has anybody from the public ever investigated and started asking these guys what the official answer is?
Well, they've tried. Nobody, there's no responses from anybody. Nobody, you will not find out. You basically get dial tones. You don't get anything from inquiring. There's nobody. Okay.
There's no idea what department it is within the U.S. government at the federal level, for example, that's in charge of, I don't know, whatever.
That's where it gets even. Again, the lines get so blurry because nobody owns. Here's where it gets even weirder. It's fragmented to the point where even if you went to one government, they would just shuffle you off to a different one. Nobody owns Antarctica.
So no one officially is even in charge, right?
No, nobody's even in charge of Antarctica. And that part alone, which I talked about in the clues, which was, do you know a single piece of real estate anywhere ever that isn't owned by somebody?
You know, they're all owned.
They're all owned. If it's not owned by...
If you look at the middle of the wilderness in the U.S., it's either owned, supposedly, even if it's illegally, it's owned by the government.
Exactly.
Or it's owned by the state, or it's owned by some rancher or something.
Exactly. It's either private or state or federal. Somebody owns whatever it is. But when it comes to Antarctica, nobody owns anything.
So is this treaty something that can be looked at?
Sure. You can look it up. It's right there online.
Under the jurisdiction of the UN or something like that? Or is it supposedly just they all spontaneously just signed it?
Exactly. No, that's what it is. No, it's not UN sanctioned or anything like that. Now, of course, there's other secondary environmental treaties which have been put in place after the fact. But in 59, why in the world would, especially when there's countries that are rebuilding from World War II, like the Soviet Union. Uh-huh. I mean, there were something like a dozen countries down there in the 50s. There was Soviet Union, Great Britain, Argentina, Chile, New Zealand, Australia, United States, so on and so on. But once Operation Deep Freeze concluded, everybody left. And the only people that
was with Byrd exploring it, you mean?
Yeah, when Byrd was exploring it in 1955-56. And what I believe happened, my leap of faith anyway, is that after pushing the better part of 30 years of flying, because he flew his own planes, and planes got way better in the 1950s, that he figured out where the outer boundary was. And it was probably thousands of miles past the coastline. It's not like the end of the earth is you know, at the Antarctic coastline. You have to go thousands of miles. But the decision was made, and I don't blame them. I totally get it, which is, all right, we can't let corporations down here, because sooner or later, they're going to, you know, all it takes is one rogue plane or rogue helicopter. Somebody goes off course. They see the wrong thing. Then what are you going to do? You know, you're going to have to take care of them. You're going to swear them to silence, or you're just going to kill them. How many people can you actually kill? So they decide, okay, you know what? Let's just make it an all or nothing deal. Nobody gets to go down here. And that way we don't ever have to worry about, you know, we'll just say, you know, now we'll put it under the cover of multiple treaties, but the Antarctic Treaty was the biggest one. And now they'll say, well, it's for science. You know, it's a scientific thing and you don't want to go down here anyway and blah, blah, blah. Haven't there
been some scientific expeditions to parts of it measuring temperatures and and stuff like that?
Sure. I mean, there's research bases down there. And if you want, and don't get me wrong, when, you know, because some people will say, well, no, I can book a trip to Antarctica. But yeah, fine. You want to spend, what, 15 grand, 10, 15,000, I think you'll do it. You can go down to the peninsula and have your picture taken with penguins and all that fun stuff. Right. But as far as going on the interior, you cannot go down there and unload your own helicopter and just take off.
You can't go inland.
No. Well, again, they have to be clever. They're not going to put up signs saying that you can't go in. They'll say you need permits. And you need permits from multiple countries because no one country owns Antarctica. And so they put enough red tape in your way to where even if you could, let's say you jump through all those hoops, eventually then they'll just monitor you. And they'll figure out where you're going, and if they have to sabotage you, they will. But again, the continent is so hostile to us as far as the temperature and the altitude. Remember, most of the continent is sitting above 14,000 feet, and altitude sickness kicks in at about 7,000 feet. So it's not fun no matter what.
Yeah.
And it, so far, it has worked really, really well. Antarctica has been a great no-go zone. And really, I don't know. I've known people that have traveled my whole life. Nobody goes to Antarctica.
So how did the research teams go in there?
Oh, the military puts them in. And the bases are there. But most of them are within striking distance of the coastline. There are a few bases somewhat. And if you want, you can pay a little extra and they will take you to what they say the South Pole is. But remember the GPS system, and people will also say the GPS system proves the Earth is a globe. I'm going, well, okay, remember the GPS, which also stands for Global Positioning System, is also a DOD project. It's the American, you know, the Americans came up with it in the 90s. There's supposedly blanket coverage of 30 satellites that are supposedly revolving around that track, you can track everything.
So what would be required to change it from that last part where you said, all right, based on this much that we know, my leap of faith is this is all the reasoning for it. What would be required to change that from your leap of faith to proving that it's right?
Proving the flat earth at this point? There's a
proof via Antarctica.
Okay, if you want to prove Antarctica out, here's how I would do it. You could do it with, well, you do it the slow way with two ships, but all you need is one ship and one plane. You probably figure out what I'm doing here as I describe it, which is you take, if the world is like a clock, if it's a flat circular clock, mm-hmm. you put the ship in the 6 o'clock position, and you take a plane with a lot of fuel on it, and you either have it go clockwise or counterclockwise, always within visual distance of the Antarctic coastline, because you can't trust GPS. GPS will not just show you, but it will show you where it wants you to think you are.
So you try to fly around Antarctica visually, right?
Yeah, basically you have to fly around Antarctica visually, and you either will run into the ship. If you could run into the ship, because remember, if you believe in mainstream science that Antarctica is only about the same island continent size of, say, Australia. Right. In fact, it's weird. Yeah. And which means you should be able to circle it in a decent plane in 18 hours, maybe. Okay. Which isn't that bad.
So the ship could just stand in one place and wait for you to come back, right?
Exactly. But if it wasn't, that plane would have to refuel long before you even got close.
Which it couldn't
and
do.
That would be a way
to refuel from, right?
Otherwise, you'd have to ditch and refuel somewhere. But here's the problem. Yeah. The Antarctic Treaty, which has been expanded, in fact, just recently, you can't get a ship even – the Antarctic Defense Force will basically escort you out. You can't even be within not just visual distance. I think it's below the 60th parallel. You can't
the test is impossible.
You'd think it'd be an innocent enough test to do. Of course, it would take some money to do because you'd need a big enough plane.
Well, yeah, but somebody curious would fund that, I would think.
You'd think. But to date, nobody stepped forward yet. But that would be a way to prove it with Antarctica, if you wanted to. And because Antarctica is the only continent that doesn't look anything like the maps. Everything else looks actually fairly similar.
Yeah. Oh. I mean, you fly around that and the whole thing is over, right?
Yeah. Because if you can fly around it and do it in a very, very short amount of time.
Or it's going to take you weeks or something, and you're never going to
make
it.
Well, it wouldn't take you weeks, but it would definitely – but let's put it – there is no plane in existence that has enough fuel to pull that off.
Yeah, you'd have to figure out the refueling question for sure. Yeah.
And by the way, you know, I know some people are having a hard time visualizing this, have never heard about it for the first time. If you want to know what the continent layout looks like on the flat Earth, you're basically looking at the UN flag.
Right.
Which was interesting. And I don't know – I don't think I told this story in the clues – that was one of the things that got me hooked, was when that Canadian artist was talking about this party that he was out to in the United States when he was a contractor for NASA doing painting work. He was a painter, photorealistic painter that they would do for mission simulations, nothing sinister.
Okay.
And the guy was saying that there was some guy all these people in the room commanded different teams. And one of them said, hey, you know, I heard a rumor that the GPS doesn't work out in Antarctica. And another guy said, hey, Fred, you better send one of your groups out there to confirm that. Another guy chimes in and goes, well, if he sends the guys out that far, they're not coming back. And the guy in our community goes, well, wait, why are they coming back? He goes, well, because GPS doesn't work out there. And he goes, why doesn't it work out there? Because it's flat. And of course, when you hear this for the first time, you don't get it. Nobody gets this the first time. And the guy then took a piece of chalk and he started drawing this big on the cement floor below these guys what the world looked like. And basically, the story goes that when he was done, the artist was looking down. He goes, I was basically looking at the UN flag. The UN flag is the model that we're working on right now. Is you know, where the North Pole is the center of the circle, and then all the continents are splayed outward. But
what's
interesting is
projection, by the way.
The projection is called. You can look it up in Wiki. It's called the azimuthal, AZIMUTHAL equidistant map.
Okay.
And what's very, very interesting about the UN flag is that Antarctica isn't on there. Which is interesting because there's all sorts of different projections where Antarctica is on there. But on the azimuthal map, the official azimuthal map, Antarctica is just this giant ring around the outside, but it was left out on the UN flag. which is, you know,
are you saying
why?
The ring
out of sight, out of mind. If you don't see it,
the ring isn't even there on the UN flag.
What, Antarctica?
Yeah.
No, it's not there. It is literally not there. In fact, instead of Antarctica on the UN flag, you have these two wreaths, these kind of Greco-Roman wreaths on the outside. And I'm going, okay, does that represent Antarctica or does that represent a barrier? What in the world are we looking at here? It's but it's interesting
just
that it's
just a nice picture. I mean, most So people have flown like around the world going on a line of latitude, for example, or the equator or something. Yeah. And that works okay. And it comes out to be, well, actually, you know what? If they flew around the world latitude wise, meaning east to west or the other way, on like the Tropic of Capricorn, that would also prove that the globe model is true or false, because the distance to do that would be radically different according to which model is correct.
That is true. You're absolutely right. If somebody flew...
You're allowed to fly at the Tropic of Capricorn, right?
I'm sorry, say it again.
You are allowed to fly a plane.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. And somebody has suggested that recently where you could, in fact, you wouldn't even have to use Capricorn and Cancer. You could just say, you know, I don't know how many degrees above or below the equator.
Yeah, just a little bit.
But
above the equator would not prove anything.
Well, but if you, did both.
Are pretty close.
But if you did both, you could compare
them. Yeah, the key is to do it below the equator.
Yeah.
But what just occurred to me is you don't have to worry about breaking into Antarctica. If you just go a little bit below the equator and you know how to use math, you know whether the model is correct or not.
Yeah. Which also, by the way, here's another interesting, and there's so many interesting points. I know we don't have time, but here's a couple other things. There was a YouTuber, not a flat earther, because some people say, well, you know, the toilets and the sinks, they drain differently, clockwise versus counterclockwise. Or the Southern Hemisphere. And there was a really big YouTuber out there. He's, again, not a flat earther, and it's called Smarter Every Day. And he wanted to prove it. He called it the swirling toilet experiment or something to that effect, but he didn't use toilets. But what he did was, it was one of the finest scientific tests I've ever seen for this, which was he did a simulcast. One guy was in the far south, one guy was in the far north. Okay. They built identical kids' wading pools with a central drain, you know, a tubular drain in the top, made sure that they waited for hours for the water to be perfectly calm.
No turbulence to throw it off or anything. Yeah.
Oh, yeah, yeah. And then instead of putting little floaty things, they used eyedroppers and did food coloring in sort of in cross patterns in the pool. Okay. And then pulled the plugs in the exact same time. I mean, they were literally talking on the phones with each other. So you couldn't say, well, it was one day versus another day.
Yeah.
And I'll be darned if the drains, it was so unbelievably slight, meaning clockwise versus counterclockwise. The guy, and he's not necessarily a debunker, this guy. He said, look, I don't know what whatever you're seeing as far as toilets flushing and drains, it's got to be the direction of the flow itself, meaning how the water is going into the bowl or the sink, because we cannot detect. I mean, it's so minute that it's just not there. So
are they saying it did not spiral? It just went straight toward the center, or what?
Well, no, it spiraled, but it took almost forever. It was so gradual that it didn't mimic at all what they were expecting. They were expecting, you know, obvious swirl patterns.
Right, right.
And it didn't happen. And yet,
did they
we
go
are
in
taught,
opposite directions?
Yeah, it was in opposite directions, but it wasn't enough to be conclusive. You know, it really surprised him. It wasn't enough to definitely, let's put it this way, wasn't enough to affect anything else that he could think of. And let me segue that into, because I know there's so much I could cover. I could talk about this for weeks, which is the some of the subject matter experts. I got to get into this because this wasn't in the clues, which was when I put these clues out, not only did I not have scientists coming against me, but I had subject matter experts that were giving me testimonials in favor of Flat Earth. Meaning guys that were in the military from all branches, Army, Navy, Air Force, Marines, Merchant Marines, structural engineers, air traffic controllers, pilots, all sorts of different pilots. But what was interesting to me were the guys that fired weapons. meaning the guys, not just the, yeah, I had a Marine sniper that wrote and said, look, because we've all heard that, for example, because this, your people will think about this, will say, well, no, you know, a sniper has to account for the spinning of the earth when they take a shot, otherwise known as the Coriolis effect. And the Marine sniper said, no, it's not even in the manual. We don't, he goes, I've taught sniper school for 3 years. We don't think of it. And that's just a mile. I've talked to tank commanders, artillery guys. One of my favorite was the missile commander from the United States Navy. He was a Sea Sparrow missile instructor for 10 years. And he goes, look, the firing solution, he goes, not only he killed two birds with one stone here. One, he goes, look, we're using a two inch pencil beam radar, and we're going point to point over 60 miles. We need that radar to be spot on. Basically, they're painting the target at 60 miles. He goes, 60 miles? He goes, how in the world are we hitting that thing with the curvature? You can't tell me that gravity is bending that laser perfectly at 60 miles to where we can hit the target. Two, we're not using the spinning of the earth, otherwise known as the Coriolis effect, in any of the firing solutions. And all the other military guys that came on all talked about this. They said the spinning of the earth, we've all heard of it, but it's never, ever used in our 9-to-5 jobs. Meaning, think about it, if you're an artillery guy shooting a cannon, think of how many more you've seen war movies, how many more calculations you would have to do, because not only do you have to come up with windage and elevation, but now you've also got to figure out, if you're shooting 30 miles with a cannon, you've got to figure out, okay, which way are we facing, north, south, east, west? That has a bearing on it. And what part of the globe you're on would also mm-hmm. have a bearing on your firing solution, because I know I'm kind of go off on tangents, but if the earth, if you believe in mainstream science, the earth is spinning at 1,000 miles an hour at the equator, mm-hmm. but it's also spinning at 0 miles an hour at the North Pole.
At the poles, right.
And which
right.
means, you know, if it gets faster as you're moving south.
Right.
Until you get to the equator. So why are nobody taking into the account these firing solutions, even though mainstream will say, well, a sniper shooting at 1 mile had to come up, we had to account for the curvature or the spinning of the earth.
Yeah.
No, we didn't, because we're shooting.
So you said all these people came on and talked about it. Came on what? What was the
venue? Oh, I'm sorry. Came on. I ended up getting a podcast out of it, a radio show.
Okay.
Somebody heard me doing an interview for another station, and they said, hey, how would you like to have your own show? And I go, okay, fine. I'm just going to talk about Flat Earth every week. And I just finished my 94th episode.
Okay.
And all these guys kept saying the same thing, which was, we all heard about the Coriolis effect and the curvature, but we never use it. The planar surveyor, most people don't know there's two types of surveyors in the world. There's not, but 99% of them, or 95, 96, are planar surveyors. Literally, they treat the world literally, you can look up in the manual, like you treat every project that like the world is perfectly flat. And this one surveyor, he'd been doing it for 30 years, and he goes, you know what, even by accident, some surveyor, because he was working on big projects 10-20 miles square, somebody has to take into account the curvature of the earth. You can't tell me that north, south, east, or west, the projects that butt up against mine, somebody's going to be out of alignment because they didn't take into account the curvature of the earth. But they don't. They're all told, just don't worry about it. Don't
you
worry about the curvature.
Basically, square properties don't fit on a curve.
On a ball. It's like covering a basketball with wheat thins. Eventually, you're going to run into gaps. It's going to happen.
Yeah.
And
well,
they
and,
all...
and with the calculations for shooting a rifle or a missile or something, it seems to me, if the globe model is correct, then if you're shooting directly east or west, then there's nothing to worry about. But if you're shooting north or south or any variable...
Oh, northwest, southeast? Oh, yeah, you'd have to take that into account.
You'd have to shoot directly east or west not to care about that.
Yeah, and it never, ever happens. I mean, look, I shoot. I can tell you right now, and granted, you know, the rifles I have don't reach out a mile, but scopes, I don't care what scope you're using, they only have two settings on it. One's for windage, one's for elevation. That's uh-huh. that's all anyone cares about.
Tell people what windage is.
Oh, windage. Sorry. How? Which? the wind's blowing in a certain direction over a distance, that wind is going to affect the bullet. It's going to blow it kind of like a car on a highway.
Yeah, it's going to like end up 10 feet to the left because the wind is blowing from your right.
Exactly. Basically, you don't ever want to shoot in high winds if you can help it, because it'd be like, it's going to blow it. Yeah, it's going to blow it off course. Right. Here's another thing. We all know that water, it reacts very quickly to momentum changes. You know, you're driving, you have a cup of coffee in your hand, you don't want to make a sharp left-hand or turn because your coffee is going to spill. Right. So how is it that the water on our world, let's say it is a globe, how the water is uniformly holding on to the globe even though it's spinning like a merry-go-round at the center at 1,000 miles an hour? You say, well, 1,000 miles an hour, yeah, but it's taking 24 hours. I'm going, I don't care. It's a lot of water. You can't tell me that centrifugal force is being completely nullified by gravity. You can't tell me that.
That is what you're being told, though, yeah.
Oh, yeah, that's exactly what we're being told.
Because when there's no wind, even though you're spinning at 1,000 miles an hour, the water doesn't show it.
No, the water doesn't show any bulges. And I know science is going to say, well, no, there's like a 500-mile bulge of water at the equator. I'm going, really? 500 miles or 500 feet or whatever it is? There's nothing there. And not only that, you're telling me the water is completely uniform at the north and south poles. There should be bald spots. I'm not saying the water is going to be spiraling around us like Saturn's rings, but it's certainly not going to be completely perfectly uniform.
Yeah, if you're moving, well, now there's another issue here too, because if you're moving at 1,000 miles an hour in one steady direction with your coffee cup full, and you don't change speed, it's not going to spill.
Right.
It's acceleration and deceleration that make it turbulent.
Oh, no, you're absolutely right. But the water, my point was that water is susceptible to motion. Meaning.
Right, but how susceptible is it to steady, unchanging speed? That's what
it's still going to be affected, because remember, use the merry-go-round observation, which is, I got to hang up on that for now. It's the merry-go-round observation, which is, even if the merry-go-round is unchanging in its speed, the water is still going to be pulled towards the edge of the merry-go-round, because that's where the
centrifugal force. Because it's not moving in a straight line, in other words.
Yeah.
There's an angular momentum involved.
Exactly. So the water in the, you cannot, the water, and I know the merry-go-round is an interesting example because it's not a sphere, but at least you get the point, which is you put water in a merry-go-round and spin that merry-go-round, it doesn't matter if you even start spinning it slowly or super slowly, eventually the centrifugal force of the merry-go-round is going to pull that water.
It's going to pull to the outside. So they're postulating that gravity does totally overcome that.
Yeah. They say that gravity completely overcomes that. I'm going, really? Completely overcomes that? It's a stretch. I'm sorry, you can't tell me.
Well, if gravity didn't overcome it, any spinning planet would lose all its water really very quickly.
Right. Yeah.
So they have to assume that gravity is strong enough to take care of that, and it's not the kind of thing that's really easy to test.
No. No, and here's you know, I'm sure you've got a few more points you got to make, but I'm trying to think of arguments that have been thrown at me over the last few months, which is some people that one of their first knee jerk reactions is, well, we can see in the sky that all the other planets are spheres, therefore we have to be a sphere, and I come back and I go, who told you they were spheres? You know, how do you know exactly that there's spheres? You know, when I look up there, I see lights. And if I have binoculars, yeah, I see a circular light. But the only three-dimensional flybys you ever hear from are from NASA.
Well, you would have to be able to beam, say, a beam of light at a planet in the center and at the edge and show that there's a difference in depth.
Yeah, but even then... again, because people will also say, well, how do you get the spherical kind of shadows on the moon, the waxing and waning crescents and the blood moon and stuff like that? Mm-hmm. I'm going, look, we can do this now. And I know I'm dated when I say that when you go to a planetarium, you know, Neil deGrasse Tyson runs the Hayden Planetarium. Yeah. We can simulate all these things right now. And I know people don't want to, you know, it's too big for some people to even think about. It's like, who says that when you walk out of that planetarium, you're just not in a bigger planetarium. Because I've had amateur astronomers come at me and say, look, I've seen the moons of Jupiter through my telescope. I'm going, that's awesome. That's great. Take that telescope, go to the planetarium. Does it look more or less spherical? And they say, well, it doesn't matter because I'm in a planetarium. I'm looking at an image. I'm going, how do you know you're not looking at an image now? How do you know?
It's very hard to tell if what you're seeing is two or three dimensional.
Exactly.
Unless it's really close to you, because then your eyes have enough of an angle so you get some depth perception.
And people will also use the sticks and shadows argument. So they'll say, well, this was proven a long time ago. And I'm going, well, you made some assumptions, though, about how big the sun was. You know, the sun was 93 million miles away hundreds of thousands of miles wide. The sticks and shadows argument also works the same if the sun is really close and not very big. You know, it's perspective. We are notoriously bad at it. So what we're saying, because people say, well, what about the sun and the moon? I'm saying the sun and the moon are just mobiles above a child's crib in this case.
It's a similar thing to when people report seeing a UFO, because it could either be, you know, hundreds of miles long and 1,000 miles up in the sky, or it could be 100 yards over their head and just look the same size.
Oh, right.
It's the same visual image.
Human beings are notorious. Bad at perspective, and we're even worse at relative motion. The argument which I used in one of my later clues, just to give people a different take, was that we've all been in stop and go traffic where we zone out for a second, and then all of a sudden you don't know if the car next to you is moving or if you let off the brake. You get this weird.
I had that experience in a train. You go into a place where you're all stopped next to each other, and then somebody starts moving.
Yep.
And you really cannot tell whether it's you or the train next to you.
No, you don't know. And we're genetically disposed to that, meaning it seems like we were kind of built to be deceived in this way, because there was a university study where they put people in fake, you know, wooden cars, and sometimes they would move the car and sometimes they would move the wall in front of them. Uh-huh. People could not tell, which is why simulators work so well, which is why some people cannot watch even a low-res video of a roller coaster on a television, because they'll get sick. It's like, look, exactly. There is no roller coaster. And it's like,
the
I
other
can't
thing
pick.
That's interesting to consider in the whole mix is that who is really moving is a totally meaningless question that can never be answered. Because the meaning of movement is always relative to what? Something else. Right? Yeah. And it's not saying point A is moving and point B is stationary. That's completely arbitrary.
Right. And so when we look up at the sky now, again, once you get into the community, you realize that, let me throw one more big one out at you, and then you can fire away wherever you want. When it comes, are we moving or the stars moving? And what's interesting is there's also something that's missing up in the sky, and that is parallax. And people are going, okay, what's parallax? Parallax is when, perfect example is if you're driving down the road, the telephone poles are going by, you know, pretty quick off the side windows. But when you look out in the distance, the mountains are going by quite a bit slower. And that is because the telephone poles are very close. The mountains are farther away.
Yeah.
Well, here's the problem with that when it comes to space. You've got the closest star is apparently something like 4 light years away. And there are some stars out there that they say are thousands, if not millions of light years away. But yet when we do time lapse of the stars, they're always rotating in the exact same fashion. There's never any deviation. They're perfectly lined up. There's these perfectly patterned circles. And science will say, no, well, you can't tell in just a night or even a week or a month. I'm going, because they said the distances are too great and we can't tell.
Well, isn't that because they say the stars aren't moving with relation to each other?
Basically, they're saying that we cannot detect. They're saying the stars are going all over the place, but we can't detect them because the distances are so vast that we can't tell them in a short time. I'm going, well, okay, that's fine. But then you're also saying that because the constellations, which we, you know, all have known, you know, Leo and Cancer and Virgo, and
they're staying the same for long periods.
The constellations haven't changed in thousands of years. So when exactly would we see the parallax? When would we see the stars doing these weird formations that never, ever happen? It's just things that people don't think about. And again, it's things that every little thing that I've mentioned here during the show they all point back to the same, for at least in our community, the same conclusion. And that is, at the very least, you are not on a globe. Now, can we say exactly what the shape is, what the arc is, and how flat it is, and what the shape of the dome is? No, we can't. But what the very least we can tell you, 100%, everyone will say the same thing in the community, is we know you're not on a globe anymore. And that the powers that be figured it out in the 1950s, for sure. I think they suspected for a long time before that. And they tried to hide it from you, and it worked. It worked really, really well. But the internet detection ability got better. You know, the access that people had to their homes, the information that are on the clouds out there, people sharing things. It only takes, you know, one guy in the middle of the night to find a frame that's out of place, and then he puts it out there, and the cumulative effect is nobody's buying it anymore. So,
all right. So what I would like to encourage listeners to do is get out of the paradigm of saying, I believe this or I don't believe that, because that's the lazy way.
Yeah.
I want people to use your brilliant creativity and think of, how do you prove that this whole idea is right or wrong? And I really want people to think about that, because it can expand your mind and the way you're thinking. And the other two things I want to bring up quickly is that because you mentioned these in the clues, and I thought they were really interesting.
Thanks.
The first one about the forbidden nature of Antarctica that just occurred to me while we were talking.
Mm-hmm.
If the flat Earth model is correct, then the Antarctic coast, the edge there of the continent,
yeah,
is really long. I don't know how many miles it is, but you must.
It'd be huge. It'd be tens of thousands of miles, 50,000 or more miles long.
So how are they managing to keep all curious explorers away from that entire long edge?
Gotcha. Oh, you asking me?
Yeah, I'm asking.
The treaty, for the most part.
So nobody's really trying to sneak through where it's not guarded or something
like that. But also, you got to remember that this place was built with some really clever natural negative reinforcements. So that, I mean, the Antarctica, really, you don't want to...
It's not a comfortable weekend trip.
No, I mean, honestly, if you're in a boat, you know, once you start seeing your first icebergs, you don't want to go there. And then
are dangerous, huh?
If you do get to the coastline, it's a 200-foot wall of ice going straight up. You get on top of that, and there's nothing, you know, there's no landmarkers. You're just on top of ice and snow.
Yeah.
Then the altitude starts...
And even compasses probably wouldn't work either.
No, that's
Although
all another
how
thing.
They behave is an interesting subject in itself.
Yeah. The fact that the North Pole seems to be the only magnetic force, and in fact, I had a military guy from Australia say that there is no magnetic south that they could ever determine.
Okay, well, anyway, that's one issue. The other one is, I thought you had a really interesting point, just a question for listeners to say, all right, how would you interpret this set of data? And that data is what you found out about flights over the South Oceans.
Oh, right. The Southern Oceans, if you want to go look it up, it's, again, I ran into this by accident. It was not even me who first found it, where you take a flight in the Southern Hemisphere. I mean, in the Northern Hemisphere, you will see it too if the distance is great enough. But when a flight gets over water 200 miles or so, the latitude and longitude will drop off. And even though you might see the graphic on the screen, the plane
won't
be there.
Off of what? You're watching it on some kind of a website?
The GPS DOD system transmits to other data to a lot of civilian stuff. So you can track your loved ones on like planefinder.net or FlightAware24 or Plane Tracker. There's a whole bunch of them out there.
So you're supposed to be able to see where the plane is at any given time with any commercial flights. Right?
Exactly. You should be able to see it no matter where it is, because remember, the GPS system is a global blanket coverage.
Yeah.
And there's satellites. The plane should never, ever, ever drop off. But right. Yet in the Southern Hemisphere, if you're looking at it, I know that they've been updated over the last couple of years and it's gotten better, but it doesn't matter. They still can't lie about the latitude and longitude. You look at those oceans, the Southern Atlantic, the Southern Pacific, and the Indian Ocean, and they're pretty much empty. There's even though we know there's supposedly planes over it. So why are the planes not being tracked?
They don't show it in the south, but they do show it in the north, is what you're saying.
Well, most of the planes in the north, you will see, with the exception of planes that are flying between islands where the land radar can't track them anymore. Basically, I'm saying that there is no GPS system. The GPS system is the old Loran system, ground-based high-intensity radar, but even that has limits, which seems to be only about 200 miles if you don't have a repeater somewhere.
I thought it was all satellites.
Satellites? Yeah, oh, you mean the old Loran system?
GPS.
Oh, GPS is supposed to be satellites. That's what I'm saying is that there is no blanket coverage for two reasons. One, because the planes, they don't want to show the routes, because the routes would absolutely not make sense on a globe model. The routes they take, and again, you know, look at all the weird connections that happen if you book flights from somewhere in Africa to somewhere in South America to somewhere in Australia. But the second part of that, which I didn't really include in the clues, was that, again, that's where we've been jumping on for the last year, which is people are coming back and saying, wait a minute, how do we know there's satellites at all down there? How do we know that everything isn't cable and ground-based and it's just towers repeating each other? How do you know there's satellites at all?
Southern hemisphere, you mean, right?
I'm sorry, what?
In the southern hemisphere or everywhere?
Everywhere. Everywhere, meaning the Loran system only works if you have places you can put towers. In the northern hemisphere, the islands, everything's packed in closer. In fact, most of the population is in the northern hemisphere. But when you get to the outer ring, there's huge chunks of ocean that have nothing in them. And, you know, rather than spend the money on ships and using them, you know, use military ships as repeaters, they decide, let's just take the planes and remove all the data and put them into approximated mode. It's brilliant. It's okay. A good plan, and it worked for a long, long time, but not anymore.
Hmm. So I'm trying to separate observation from interpreting theory.
Sure.
And because observation is just anybody can verify it. And the observation that you're making about the southern hemisphere flights is, number one, during a flight across the South Atlantic or South Pacific,
yep,
there's virtually no GPS data given for those flights. Is that right?
Exactly. There is no, there is almost none. The latitude and longitude will change from numbers to basically a question mark. In fact, that's interesting. Okay. They would say approximated or estimated, because what they really mean is we have no idea where that plane is.
If it was a satellite system, that would not be the case.
No,
right?
The satellite system, the GPS system, I mean, it stands for global positioning system. It doesn't stand for partial positioning system or, you know, northern hemisphere. It's the satellites are supposedly everywhere. There should be no dead spots. Okay. And we see dead spots all over the place, especially in those big oceans in the south. And that should not be. Satellites is easy. The satellite doesn't make any difference where you are.
Right.
It doesn't matter if there's no islands there or not. And yet that's not the case.
There's two possible interpretations of why there's no GPS in the southern hemisphere. One is that, as you mentioned, there is a possibility that it's really not a satellite system, it's ground-based.
Right.
And there's not enough ground bases to make it work in the southern hemisphere.
Right.
Except on the continents. And the second one would be that if the flat Earth model is correct, the lines of longitude are too far apart.
Yes.
And showing GPS would show that immediately.
Yeah, the routes would be so far out there. Again, you can look this up. You can try to book a flight anywhere in the southern hemisphere to somewhere in the southern hemisphere and see how many nonstop flights you can find. The routes.
That's a good homework assignment for listeners, actually.
Yeah, the connections will send you into places that we would never, that would double the distance. In a lot of cases. I mean, there's some places where literally from Africa to somewhere in Australia, it was taking with connection somewhere like 40 plus hours for someone
to go nonstop straight along a line of latitude from one to the other.
Yeah, just fly a freaking 13 hours, fly it across the ocean, do it. I mean, yes, there's a couple flights that are out there that do it. And I'm not saying that the flights aren't there, but I'm saying that when you try to book those flights, if you try to follow one of those flights, you'll never be able to prove the route because the data will drop off. And that's why
you're saying maybe the flight is not there.
It may not. It may not be there. I mean, it may be. I mean, I know people have flown the flights. I have no doubt about that. But well, here's the other trick they do, which I thought was very, very interesting. They will say it's a nonstop. This you'll like this. They will say it's a nonstop, but they will take you to a fuel depot anyway. Because technically, from the airline standpoint, I did not know this until last year. If you land to get fuel, but nobody gets off or on the plane, it's not considered a stop. That seriously counts? And yeah, also, I mean,
if you're flying across those uninhabited ocean stretches that you're talking about, there isn't any place to stop anyway. So how do they do that?
Well, they go slightly north and they find an island. There are fuel islands. In fact, there's like two or three, and I can't remember the name of them. They're funny names, where they will actually stop. We know this because social media has changed the game, where people have tweeted. It's like, I have no idea why we stopped at this island. And they were on nonstop flights.
But what should keep coming up is that it takes them twice as long as it's supposed to.
Yeah, it takes them way longer than it should. Now, does that mean, you know, that there are that you can't get some from somewhere in a decent amount of time? No, I'm saying that it in most cases, we're still trying to figure out. We know there's some scale issues with the UN flag map. We know there's some scale issues there. We don't know when you get out to the southern hemisphere. The distances, there's something wrong with the map. We know this. We just can't. We're still trying to nail down exactly what it is.
Yeah, that's a big point, because if somebody could make it almost in the correct time anywhere in the southern hemisphere, then the whole flat Earth model is in question until that's solved.
Well, part of it anyway, because you got to remember, if the route, here's the thing, eventually some of these routes, and you look on the flat Earth map, have to make these weird these straight lines which cut across land. But even during the straight lines, there's a couple hours. It's not like the map is completely out of whack, but there's still some issues where the plane still should arrive a couple hours later, and it doesn't. Which means, okay, does that mean the continent is smaller? Does that mean the ocean is smaller? We don't know. We're trying to work out the details there.
Okay. Well, would you agree, as kind of a wrap up point, that the purpose here is to get people to be, first of all, aware of the things that they know that are based on a belief that they just accept versus the things that they know that they have actually determined from their own experience or found out somehow. Yeah. And that once you know the body of knowledge that you have that's based on assumptions, start using your creativity to think, how would you prove whether those assumptions are true or not, rather than just changing your belief? I mean, because that's not what you're asking people to do. You're not saying drop one blind belief for another. No. I think what you're saying is start becoming conscious and checking things out, because then you know that a belief that was based on assumption could change to a belief based on actual knowledge.
Yeah. Yeah. Again, you know, be how open-minded are you? You know, and start with the most base. If you think you're open-minded, this is your test. Start with the most basic thing there is. How do you know you're on a globe? How do you really know? You know, think about that for a second. Do you know just because you've been told so many times of your life, or do you know because, you know, you saw a picture once and you bought it?
Well, and then you can get deeper into that, because the human being, as you know, a non-physical being living in a physical body for a while, is looking out through a programmed intellectual mind, a bunch of emotions based on experience, and very limited senses that only perceive a tiny bit of what's outside. Yeah. And so, based on those limitations, which everybody seems to have, how do you actually know anything?
True. Yeah, unless you can test it for yourself.
And this is what things look like to me.
Yeah, I apologize for the people that are out there going, "Holy smokes, I'm not going to be able to sleep for a week." I completely hear you. It's one of those things where, again, everybody who starts down this road, and I'm warning you in advance, if you're happy with your life and you don't want to mess with anything, by all means, you know, don't look into this, because that's your only defense. If you try to disprove this, if you try to go after it, you're going to run into it, because you're going to end up like everybody else in the community.
I think this is our first Lost Arts Radio episode of Twilight Zone Series 2. And the purpose of that series, which was great, and I thought Rod Serling did a great job, is just to get you to question, and really that's supposed to be both the essence of scientific, real scientific exploration plus real spiritual discovery.
Yeah.
Neither one is based on, well, I guess I'll just believe this.
Yeah.
They're based on trying to find out what's real.
Yep.
And that makes things a lot more interesting.
Yeah. Anyway. So,
yeah, you want to leave people with anything other than that to just remember from all of what you've said?
The only thing I want to leave them with is don't take my word for it. Don't believe a single thing I've said. You know, just check it out for yourself. And the community is vast now. It is so much bigger than it was even 2 years ago. And I don't know why this awakening is happening the way it is, but just, you know, forget about, you know, looking to my stuff. Just go into the easiest way is just go into YouTube, type in Flat Earth, and don't set any filters and see what happens. And it's amazing the amount of content that's been produced.
Recently. Some people have been exploring these things in other
ways. Oh, yeah. What inspires people, it generates so much interest and curiosity that not only, I mean, we get so many people in the community that just created their very first YouTube channel, and now they've got tons of subscribers and making videos every week, and it's a massive community and very supportive of each other.
I think one of the main messages is to drop fear. You know,
yeah.
As far as I can tell, it's never helped anybody do anything. And if the Earth is a globe shape, it's going to be a globe shape even if you explore these other things.
Yeah.
I mean, if you look at other theories and find out they're nonsense, then the globe is still there. It's not dangerous.
Yeah.
It's just an exercise in stretching your mind.
Yeah. So. Yeah, again, it's. I'm curious to see how this will progress, but if last week is any indicator, you know, when the NBA's best point guard came out during his podcast and said, oh, yeah, by the way, theirs is flat. So it's just bizarre the way
it's also going to be interesting to see the response to that.
The media has descended upon him. I can't, you know, it's interesting. The networks have avoided it for the most part for mainstream television, but all your sports stations have covered it. So we've gotten more mainstream media exposure in the last 2 weeks than we have in the previous 2 years.
Yeah, because if they all want him, you know, admitted immediately into a psychiatric hospital, that's probably going to give more attention to your groups.
Yeah, I don't think that'll happen, though. I mean, he's won a championship.
That's true. He's in a good
position. At the top of his game, so.
Right. All right. Well, it's been a really fun experiment with you. I hope it gets people to think. And hold on, and we'll say goodbye in the break here.
Okay, there goes Mark Sargent, our representative for today from the Flat Earth Movement. I wanted to share this experience with you as an exercise, not just in being tolerant of points of view that may be really different than where we're coming from, but also an exercise of openness. In other words, fearless listening to any point of view that we can really learn from anybody. And I don't mean in a condescending way at all, because sometimes where you least expect it, something really amazing will come through. And you don't have to worry about that, because whatever is true is still going to be true, no matter who is saying what theory and what argument there is, no matter how many members there are in a group that thinks one thing or no members or whatever, none of that has any effect on what is true. So what's true is going to stay that way. You don't have to prop it up. You can relax and feel free to investigate whatever you need to find out. And there's a lot of interesting things to investigate, as you may have noticed if you've been in this world for very long. I mean, even the baby that just gets born, as soon as their eyes start to focus, they start being amazed at the things around them to explore, and they try to reach out their hand and kind of triangulate the position of different things hanging over their crib or wherever they're lying in bed. And we should have the same kind of amazement and wonder about what's all around us. Marcus Rothkranz talks really brilliantly about that quite a bit, that, you know, people tend to get cynical and jaded and lose interest in what's around them. It's not because what's around us becomes uninteresting. It's because we let ourselves become uninteresting. And I mean, I've been guilty of that as much as anybody in huge parts of my life. But once you realize that, you don't have to continue that. And remember, as far as fear is concerned, which is a big impediment to exploring anything, fear is not possible in a really relaxed state if you're wide awake. I mean, you can be relaxed in a dream and, you know, be having nightmares or something. But if you're wide awake and you're relaxed at a deep level inside, it's not possible, as far as I know, to be fearful. And normal, whatever people consider normal, but our real normal is, let me say it this way, our real normal condition is not what's common. It's not what we see around us on the 3D world level. And this radio program is about rediscovering what your normal state actually is. You know, are you brave enough to do that? Are you open enough to see it? Or have you fallen for this brainwashing that whatever is unknown is terrifying? That's complete nonsense. I mean, there's no basis for that at all. In fact, as things are unknown and you run into them, then they become known and you can find out what they really are. And we might as well know, you know, what's actually going on. So what you discover along the way to investigating those things, those are all the lost arts, which include clues to who you are. The major thing that you have to find out. And based on who you are, what are your real capabilities? What's your real normal state in life? You know, do you really have to age like people think? Do you have to get all these diseases? Do you have to be sick all the time? Do you have to feel tired? You know, and you can just go on and on with that list. And there's so much, as we found out talking to Mark, that we think we know, that we've just decided to accept as a given, as a belief. And so anyway, that was the value of what I think is looking at ideas that you're not used to, whether it's flat earth or anything else, rather than just making fun of it. Take it as an exercise about you, not about the idea or the group that's saying it, but about you. How relaxed and centered and open are you? And just relaxed and confident enough to look at anything. And that doesn't mean you have to talk to people that are malicious or overly aggressive or trying to take advantage of you. That's a different thing. But if somebody's just, you know, putting forth an idea that they sincerely believe, it gets really interesting if you're willing to look at it. So one thing I realized in talking to Mark, that the whole point of this thing should be not just more and more and more discussion and more members in the group, or, you know, saying this is nonsense or this is absolutely true, you're stupid if you don't believe it, or if you do believe it or whatever. The point is to find out. You know, that's our main point in life, actually. And so I told Mark this after we talked to off the air, is that, and he agreed, the point is to find out and to be able to prove it definitively for ourselves and maybe for other people that it is or is not true. So if you followed the clues that we talked about and that Mark presented and that he's got in his playlist, you can find it on YouTube, Flat Earth Clues. I thought it was a really good series, kind of like Twilight Zone in a good way. How would you solve the question? Not just to point out, well, I believe it or I don't believe it, because that doesn't mean anything. You know, is it true? And so one thing you could do is, he mentioned that in 50 miles, there'd be a big drop of, you know, he said several thousand feet. I think it's actually, geometrically speaking, if the globe model is true, then there should be something like a 1600 foot drop, something like that, which is way more than you need to have things disappear. So if you can see ships 50 miles away, this really brings up a serious question. And the other thing is, on the azimuth, I have to talk fast because we're almost out of time here, but on the azimuthal map, the one that the UN uses as a flag, the space in the southern hemisphere is vastly bigger. So why couldn't somebody explore, not even just with a plane, but what about with a car going across continents like Australia? Wouldn't that tell you something? And what does that map actually show compared to what you would find if you drove across Australia? So But this is, again, this is just an example of anything in life that you can just explore the same way. A lot of the things that are happening to us with our bodies and health issues and events in life, it's complicated and hard to see cause and effect because of the time delay. You know, if you eat junk food or use Wi-Fi or breathe chemtrail residues or get vaccines or eat GMOs, you usually don't immediately die. Now, you might sometimes from vaccines, but most of this stuff, you don't die right away. And so we tend to not pay attention. But since the biggest secret is to discover who you actually are and what your real normal state is and what your abilities are, you have to start paying attention and realizing that this time delay factor is like a fog that's obscuring everything, and start observing clues, just like Mark has done with flat earth clues that he brought up, clues about your own identity, your normal state, about things happening around you, about events, what leads to something else. It's like, just because one thing follows another doesn't mean the first thing caused the second thing. It might have been a coincidence or caused by something that you didn't even see. And, you know, that's often brought up in scientific discussions, real ones, is that just because one thing follows another, it doesn't mean there's a cause and effect there, but there might be. And so you can become a great explorer of your own life if you want to, and have it become incredibly exciting and extremely interesting to discover what's actually going on with yourself mostly, but also with everything going on around you. So anyway, be a great explorer if you want to. It makes things a lot of fun. I just remind you to see the Flat Earth's playlist on Flat Earth Clues playlist that Mark's put up, and also his site, MarkSargent.com. And you remember that our site, LostArtsRadio.com, is up there, and we're putting all kinds of new educational videos and articles, which are all totally free, and they're supposed to be interesting and helpful for the people that read them. Take a look at that. Well, I try to put new ones up there almost all the time. And if you want to support us without spending any money at all, if you ever buy anything on Amazon, which some people do, I know, instead of going to Amazon.com, this was a brilliant idea of John, one of our listeners, go to Smile, S-M-I-L-E, like smiling, smile.amazon.com. It'll give you the exact same website, same prices, same products, and it'll ask you if there's a nonprofit you want to support. If you feel like supporting us, go to their list and find Lost Arts Research Institute in Arizona, and they'll give, I think it's 0.5%, like 50 cents out of every $100 that's spent. And the very first $1 billion that's spent like that, we could start to build our school. I mean, it's not very, you know, high percentage, but it helps. And if you happen to have lots of money and resources and you want to help us and, you know, help the work of the Institute, which is to build a school and to teach what the research has found out in health and consciousness and all kinds of interesting things, there's a donate button for that on the LostArtsRadio.com website. And also the Research Institute has its own website. If you ever want to see just a little glimpse of the bigger project, that's at LostArtsResearchInstitute.org. And you'll see something about our bigger project. Anybody that has any questions, you know, about any of that can certainly reach me through Richard@LostArtsRadio.com. And if you want to make comments or suggestions or anything about the show, you can send them to me there. Remember that on our website, thanks to Doug setting it up, we've also got the forum and the free sign up for the newsletter, which don't cost anything. And that's at LostArtsRadio.com. The Saturday discussion open call-in show is also there for you to participate in if you want to, or listen. You reach it at the exact same time as this one, but on Saturday instead of Sunday. And if you want to try out your observer identity during the week and see new interesting things that you notice, hopefully there will be some of them during the week. Try it out. See what happens. I'll be doing the same thing. I do that all the time anyway as a researcher. And I'd love to hear from you, or just listen in if you want, or share what you find out on the forum on LostArtsRadio.com. So anyway, I really appreciate your giving us a little bit of your time and sharing this journey with us, and we'll see you next time.